graphic use of Chosen here tells us that Diavolo is 100% certain that he has absolute control of his own fate thanks to King Crimson, something that would not be entirely untrue given the nature of his ability, but as I will explore later, fate is not on his side in the long run. The main point here is that Diavolo was overcome with avarice the moment fate went his way once, and thus extremely overconfident in his ability to escape fate, causing an assumption that he was in control, a credence which ultimately leads to his own downfall.
No, it doesn't.
No, absolutely not.
What led to his downfall was the arrow mysteriously jumping to Giorno and Giorno stabbing himself.
Because, but then again, every single time that he looks at it and goes, oh, something's supposed to happen, and it doesn't. That, of course, that's going to be a notch in his belt. I think that as well. But then you also have times where he didn't foresee things, like Bruno punching him, and he just stopped the punch and just going, well, that was close. I didn't get punched. So that's him mitigating damage that he could have taken, but he didn't. So, of course, he's going to be like, yeah, fate is on my side because I didn't get punched.
A further note on Diavolo through Doppio. The most compelling evidence for this not being speculation, and actually Diavolo's intended personality for me, would have to be in chapter 541, the island of Sardinia, Storm Warning. Here, Doppio has a brief exchange with a fortune teller who is genuinely able to uncover Doppio's true nature and past, something that evidence...
Why? How?
He's an actual fortune teller. I have no problem with that, because the fortune teller with Zeppeli in part one, they exist. Fortune tellers actually exist in this world, and they tell the fortune, and it always happens. I have no problem with this fortune teller knowing how to do this.
I do. Just random fortune teller in the middle of the street seeing exactly this dude, as opposed to the fortune teller for Zeppeli, it was his master, his trainer, a Hamon master. It's just some random dude.
Yeah, but the dude also said he felt something from Diavolo that he hadn't felt from other passerbys.
Mm-hmm. But Doppio just happens to be there.
No, that's what I'm saying.
For this moment.
No, I'm sure the fortune teller himself is always on that street corner just peddling for change. He's
but Doppio just happens to...
cross paths with him, is what you're saying.
Doppio, of course, fate. Doppio does of course, not fate. Come out...
Of course, fate.
Doppio does not come out much. It's usually Diavolo in his little tower hiding. But Doppio comes out, sees this dude for what is presumably the first time in a very long time. And now, and then he's just, it's a very contrived thing that doesn't really amount to anything other than more fate stuff.
Fate.
You know what?
This is 10 stars. Before Doppio murders him in cold blood. In one sense...
Diavolo murders him. Doppio doesn't do that. They're two separate people.
This is simply another way to show Diavolo's paranoia surrounding his identity. But to me, there is simple but heavy symbolism at work here. Putting it bluntly, Doppio kills a fortune teller. We know this fortune teller has accurate insights into fate. So does it seem far-fetched that this is in fact a metaphor? I believe that Doppio killing the...
What? A metaphor. Wait, let's hear what it is.
So, because he kills a fortune teller, there's a metaphor of him killing his fate as he always.
You know what? You done already predicted it.
Is that what Dang it is? It.
Never mind. Gong.
I believe that Doppio killing the fortune teller is a direct reference to him attempting to eliminate and ignore a fate set out for him.
What fate?
Yeah. The fate of somebody finding out who he is? The fate of...
But it's set out for him, which would mean he would have to see it. And he's eliminating, and that's the metaphor. Mm. Or is it just that this fortune teller now knows him, and he doesn't want that, so he kills him?
But how do we tie fate into this?
The fortune teller told him some stuff?
That was fated to happen? Can we tie his fate into this? We need fate.
Maybe he did tell him some stuff. No, he was about to, and then he killed him. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I guess
it wasn't his fate to tell him. Mm-hmm. We can say that.
That's perfect.
Yeah,
it was. Write it down. Was his fate to die at this moment, mm-hmm. and that's the metaphor, and the tying around and everything, and it's just a neat little bow. It's like a poem. It rhymes. It's like poetry. Lucas, what were you...
Refuses to accept the man's offers and talents, much like he refuses to accept fate. But in the end, fate's inescapable.
He refuses to accept fate?
What fate?
What fate?
And in what way does he refuse to accept it?
I guess because he thinks he's changing it. So he's not accepting what he sees, so he's changing it. Mm. That's the only thing I could think of. Except, you know, it always happens anyway, so. So why is Fate mad? Why is it trying to punish him? Because he believes he could change it, even though it's still playing out exactly how Fate wants?
But I thought Fate was fluid.
But it can't be, because it always happens. Anything that set a course that we see a actual course, it happens. Again, we say, if Rolling Stones had predicted Mista in the stone and then Mista did not die, you could say, wow, you can change Fate, it's fluid, blah, 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 blah.
But no.
But no. Everything just happens as it meant to be.
Even the stands of the protagonist and villain in this part are directly connected to predetermined outcomes. From Diavolo, we have King Crimson and Epitaph, abilities that allow a user to observe actions before they happen, directly demonstrating to them the immediate fate of their surroundings, and then for them to be able to erase the time in which the actions causing that fate happened. This is perfect for Diavolo, as it mirrors his mentality exactly. Whilst King Crimson is able to predict Fate, and he believes he can change it, it is in fact not this way. King Crimson removes the cause, but at the end of the day, the effect still remains.
Oh,
in this
my
sense,
goodness,
it is
back to
reminder.
This.
So Fate still happens, so again, why is he being punished?
Because he believes that he could change
Fate. But he's not.
But he thinks that he can.
But he isn't.
Thought crimes.
Fate cares about thought crimes?
Yeah, apparently.
Putting him in thought jail?
Apparently.
For eternity?
For eternity!
Because he thought he could change you, Fate?
That he is so close to being able to alter Fate, but the effect still remains. Diametrically opposed to this is Gold Experience Requiem, an ability that removes effect but maintains cause. This ability is the one exception to the inevitability of Fate, as it is able to stop exactly that, which is what makes it the perfect, ironic, poetic end.
No, it's not perfect.
Yes, it is.
It's not ironic, and it's not poetic.
Yes,
it's awful.
It's all three of those things. Cause and effect. Cause gone, effect stays.
Effect
okay. Gone, cause days.
The gone. Effect was them getting punched. Gold Experience Requiem and Giorno getting punched. That gets erased. So now his consciousness is just dying forever.
Yeah. Get it?
I don't get it.
What?
How's that poetic?
Fate.
How's that ironic?
He got trapped in fate because he...
What fate? Whose fate?
His fate.
What fate?
His.
Based on what?
Yeah, this.
From what?
Fate.
What fate?
Is.
That's the argument!
Dude! I need somebody face to face to sit here and explain this to me. Because I got questions. We need to break this down because they're just dropping this. Bam! He got punished. Ironic. Done. And I go, wait a second. How does this make sense?
And he's already on to the next fate
thing. He gone.
He done hopped in the car and just went to the next fate town.
I look down at my phone, can't look back up, and he just disappeared. Cloud of smoke.
He Batman'd you. You turned around and just like, oh, how does he do that? And it's just like, fate man away.
For Diavolo. He got what he wanted. As a man running from fate his entire life, it's fitting to an incredible degree that his end is being unable to reach that fate. This is what makes Gold...
What fate?
He was running from fate, but now he can't reach that fate. What fate?
And what fate did he run from? Because they always happened.
And you said it yourself. He believed that he was changing fate.
But he wasn't actually.
So what? Please explain the fate.
Fate man away!
Explain the fates that you're talking about. That he, dude, you can't just say fate. You can't.
I mean, he asked for 11 minutes. What are you talking about? I would submit to you.
Evidence A, Your Honor.
Case closed. Do.
This is what makes Gold Experience Requiem an exceptionally written ability in my eyes. Although the actual use is somewhat of a deus ex machina in many people's opinion,
What? And Oceanus, we got words.
In many people's opinions.
Oh, no.
He didn't say his own.
Oh, no.
He's about to say no. If
you know what?
He's it fits so thematically that it doesn't matter.
He's going to throw his hands up and go, I have no opinion on this. You guys speculate. That way, the people that think it is a deus ex like me and the people that don't think it's a deus ex like me.
I'm thinking that he's going, no, it is a poetic, thematic, blah-diddy, blah-diddy, blah.
In my eyes. Although the actual usage is somewhat of a deus ex machina in many people's opinion, I think whether it is or isn't is not a relevant question. What matters is that it was well executed and
Kind of both of ours.
Kind of both. So, the arrow flies over magically. No way to know how that happened. He grabs it, stabs himself. The thing comes out. He shoots a rock, which allows life to come out of other rocks, and then he's punched, and Diavolo's consciousness dies forever. And that was the good execution of this stand.
It is also a stand that happens to be exactly what he needs to defeat Diavolo. He can control it, semi, unlike Ponarath, who's just like a wild whatever stand. These things are well executed.
Symbolic ability to end part five with.
Symbolic ability to end part five with. That's what you need to look at it as. It's well executed because it was symbolic. Dude. Was it consistent? Was it...
But again, you've got the ending of Kira and that's symbolic, but I don't care. It was just a good moment.
Yes.
So, what are we doing? In fact, it was an ironic and poetic end in both his head getting crushed and the girl thing. But I don't care. I just think it was a really good occurrence. It tied everything back together. And everybody went home happy.
He was fated to die there, though.
I guess so. I guess fate.
We just need to throw that in there just so we can get our fate counter.
The fates and the gods and the deus exes and whatever happened.
In part five with earlier, I mentioned Diavolo believing he was chosen by fate.
That is a great.
I love that. It is so good. It's amazing.
I mentioned Diavolo believing he was chosen by fate. This is another major way in which fate is presented within part 5, for which we should look at several moments in the final fight. Firstly, the concept of fate choosing people is referred to repeatedly by multiple characters, in particular when Giorno pierces Gold experience with the arrow. Here, Diavolo believes that Giorno was not found worthy by the arrow to wield Requiem, claiming he doesn't have the right. This is once again...
But he was, and Dio wasn't. Why? How did... Because he automatically just didn't... Dio did not know what would happen if you were stabbed and you weren't chosen. But he automatically assumed it. Why? He didn't wait or anything. He should just be like, something might happen. I'm going to kill you. Because if you look at it with Ponarath, same thing happens. It was stabbed and then it was like a minute later and then Requiem came out. What's your point in bringing this up?
Fate.
He doesn't have the right. This is once again Diavolo persisting that he is the true chosen ruler, even...
Yeah, okay. That's again Diavolo talking about it. Didn't you just say multiple characters talk about this? Or is it said multiple times by the same person that's been saying it from the very beginning? Again, the rest of the characters don't care.
They're just trying to kill this dude.
The end. However, what comes next is of course the evolution of Giorno's stand into its Requiem form, an event which is noted by Trish as Giorno qualifying and not being rejected.
How did you know that?
Again, the arrow has never rejected anybody.
Yeah.
It evolved Kira.
A piece of garbage.
A definable piece of garbage. Quantifiable piece of trash.
There was no, I'm going to use this for good and accept my fate. He actively rejected his fate. Doesn't matter. But he was just like, I'm going to use this power for nefarious purposes.
And only.
He would have gotten away with it. If not for
those pesky kids.
If not for one small thing. That's all that happened. But he was on track to be the pure victor. It wasn't like Josuke just appeared in front of him and just went, oh, I see you. You're Kira. There is no one-to-one comparison of, I'm going to grab the arrow and it just flies away.
It was in any part.
It was a mistake that he was tricked into, as opposed to just this magical hand flinging something into somebody else's hand. That's dumb.
Repeated field of words throughout these chapters really push the idea of fate choosing, and specifically fate choosing those in the morally correct area, as...
Why did Kira get his sand evolved?
Mm-hmm.
Why did the people that were morally correct die? Why was Diavolo allowed to kill them? Why is now the time that Diavolo dies, as opposed to all the other people?
Why? Why are these... Why? It's just fate on a time delay, I guess.
And why does fate care about morals? Good, bad, whatever. Why would fate care about any of that?
And again, how does fate deem what is good and what is bad?
On top of that, why are we talking about fate like it's some type of person or thing? Like it's not just some nebulous construct. Like it's not just some theme that authors put into books.
Why do you have to be accepted by fate? What is that? For being morally righteous and all that? What?
Fate chose Giorno to triumph over Diavolo's evil. As
he was always destined to do that there, if fate so deemed it. It's not because of Giorno being moral in some abstract way in this particular moment.
It was
going
to happen no matter what.
Always going to happen.
Even if he was 10 feet away from the arrow and Dia was a foot away from it. It's going to happen because it did.
Such, it becomes clear that what Araki meant by being worthy is in fact righteousness.
No, impossible. Because we've seen before that it happened. And again, either A, why was Ponorath's stand not worthy, or B, why was it worthy? Not worthy in that it wasn't a full requiem, or worthy that it became a requiem. Now, you could say that he died so he wasn't able to control it, which means he was deemed... chosen or whatever. He was deemed righteous. That's the word I'm looking for. He was deemed righteous. But again, a stand is a representation of the soul, and his soul survived. So what happened there?
And also, he said that when he crawled himself out from that cliff, he mistakenly stabbed himself with the arrow on his stand with Wild. That was the first time that it happened. So he wasn't dying then, but he couldn't control it.
So what happened?
Was he not chosen? And we have to discuss, why didn't it go to Trish or Mista? They're both righteous. They're both doing the right thing.
Especially Trish.
She was controlled, and she was just like, I'm going to stop you from getting the arrow with the spikes, girl. And then it ended up with her getting a shot to the gut. She was very righteous. So was Mista. You said it yourself. Happy go lucky dude that accepted his fate. Why was he not
chosen? Saving girls from getting raped.
Why was he not chosen? Why Gio? I guess we just have to accept that fate chose him for some arbitrary reason, because he's the most righteous.
In what way though? Based on what?
Yes.
It can't be based on his story.
Because he's done essentially the same thing as other people. He's had roughly the same equal hardship as others. But he both gets to live and gets the arrow. Why?
The final piece in the puzzle of this story resolves the moral gray area that this part has had from beginning to end, evidencing which...
Moral gray area? What?
There's a quantifiable good guy and a quantifiable bad guy. Now, I can see if, like, La Squadra were actually really good guys and... Bruno Tain was tasked with eliminating them because they had defected. I can see something like that. But that's not what happened.
Yeah, no.
It was just a bunch of people trying to kill him, and they were like, well, we gotta kill you, because you're trying to kill us.
Yeah.
It was self-defense.
You're gonna kidnap the boss's daughter and basically use her to ransom to get to the boss and then kill him and then gain all the power.
And then Bruno died for his morals. So, moral gray area? Like, I don't know what you mean.
Abakio did a very good thing at the end of his life by helping some kids get a ball out of a tree. He didn't have to. That's a good thing. But he died because of it. Why?
Fate deemed him.
But
he had redeemed himself by, and so his life was complete.
And now your life is forfeit, sir. That's all the, well, the end. Full circle.
Full chapter on that book. Bye.
Side is good, which side is evil, and proclaiming that fate chooses the good to last forever, and rejects the bad, condemning it to be lost forever. Now,
based on what? And this is clearly, clearly in fan pages for these manga. Fan translations. Because mm-hmm. they couldn't get the typesetting right in the speech bubble.
It's just leaning all out that mug.
So you're drawing your entire conclusion based on words that might not actually have been said.
But even if they are, you still need to interpret it in whatever way you need to interpret it to fit your narrative.
And this narrative is...
Neither it, you nor...
It's just such a fate bucket. Just being poor.
Condemning it to be lost forever. Now, neither you nor anyone else will ever manipulate absolute truth. This line in particular...
What is absolute truth?
What does that mean?
What is it?
Because... Dia never manipulated anything in terms of fate. And the absolute truth would be fate, because no matter what, it can't be changed. It's going to happen. Yeah. That's the absolute truth. And Dia has never changed that. So what in the absolute truth has he changed?
Something. Something that this dude knows and he's not telling.
Hey, we just have no clue about.
You got it. You got it. You dig.
Also shows us that irrespective of whether Giorno wanting to lead the gang is a morally sound goal, that isn't what matters. The morality of one's actions isn't what fate looks for. It is instead the purity of one's heart and beliefs.
Then why didn't Trish get it?
Yeah. What has she done that was wrong?
Because we've seen Giorno literally scamming people.
Dude.
So why didn't she get it?
Yeah. She's the most just one there.
She's just a girl.
We've not seen her kill anybody. She has zero deaths on her hand.
She has zero crimes on her hand.
She's just basically thrust into the story.
With a lot of doubts that she gets over as she becomes a strong member of the gang. And then she prevents her father from getting the arrow, and then the arrow go, finally, Giorno.
I can finally reach Giorno.
Based on what?
Yes, absolute truth.
This is why Giorno and the gang win. One further moment within this.
Then why didn't La Squadra win?
Yeah. They were doing it for revenge. That's a pretty just thing. I guess not. Just enough for fate
to decide that it was righteous enough in the, or because they were trying to get Trish to get to him, they were doing it nefariously as opposed to the righteous way of just fighting against Diavolo, I guess. Fate.
This is why Giorno and the gang win. One further moment within this fight that it is really important to acknowledge is Bruno's parting words to Giorno. Fate is a sleeping slave, and we were able to unleash from it.
No, you weren't.
No.
Everybody that was supposed to die, died.
Yep, 100%. You were not. You did not.
You did nothing.
You did nothing to cause the arrow to fly towards Giorno. You did nothing. these are just words. Words that people need to cling to.
Dude, grasping so hard onto.
That's victory. These words wrap up the fight neatly, showing us one more example of a character embracing their fate despite what it means for them and still being happy with the overall outcome. That outcome being that all of...
But again, this is based on a bunch of fans writing this. It might not even be the correct translation for it. Because we've seen stuff like this before.
The main group were collectively able to overcome their past to make good be evil, thus unleashing from their negative pasts for a positive...
Okay, so again, why was Mishita punished by going to jail for doing nothing but righteousness? Yeah. I guess fate just, whatever, took a nap. Woke up like, oh, what happened to Mishita? All right, I gotta do
Destiny,
something.
Destiny, I told you to handle that.
Huh?
Pushing them from their negative pasts for a positive future. Even those deceased are at peace. Now, from my point of view, this fight is a thematically flawless end to the part.
Whoa! See? No, that's all. It's a thematically flawless. Whatever happens, it doesn't matter because the themes fit. So as long as the themes fit, it's thematically flawless.
That's not what just happened. That's,
you can't have it that way.
That's not
you
what
have
happened.
To look at it outside of the themes. It doesn't make sense for the arrow to fly towards him. Point blank period. How did they win? Because he got the arrow. How did they get the arrow? Because it flew to him. He won because the arrow flew to him. Point blank period. Doesn't make sense. It's bad. Thematically flawless, whatever. It's bad. Just because they say the word fate so many times in there
doesn't make it thematically flawless.
Just because you can justify all your headcanons and thoughts and crap because they are also spewing it at you doesn't mean it's thematically perfect.
Fight is a thematically flawless end to the part. I couldn't have imagined a fight that captured the essence of the story in a better way, and there was nothing I could have come up with that finished the journey in a more relevant, suitable way.
Relevant and suitable
oh my
way?
Goodness.
What way could it possibly be irrelevant? You're words! Just words!
Joseph coming out and humming him to death. That would have been irrelevant.
More relevant, suitable way. But Araki found something.
Sleep for sleeping slaves.
I forgot about sleeping slaves.
I did too. I didn't think you would.
Yeah, I thought that
but
was
But he's going that is even better than the end. Has he said the word Trish?
No.
The Sleeping Slaves epilogue takes that theme of fate that has been in the part throughout and ties up the story with a lovely little bow on top, making this tale that much more artistic and excellent. Rolling Stones is the chronological first stand that the gang face in the story, and it appears to be a manifestation of fate itself. This is particularly relevant to show the reader at the end of the story, as all of the analysis I have made so far has somewhat assumed a sentience of fate, given its ability to...
The biggest problem with Sleeping Slaves is it has to be a literal manifestation of fate just to make y'all happy. Just to be like, no, but fate was always here. You see that? Look, here it is. There's nothing to think about here.
Yeah, there really is nothing. Because if Araki goes, okay, I'm going to have this stone that tells who died. And then throughout the story, he's thinking, okay, so I want Narancha to die here. I want such and such to die here. Oh, yeah, the stone thing. I need to put their faces in the stone.
And thus fate.
And thus fate.
Choose people and events, but that assumption is affirmed by Rolling Stones. This stand is fate presenting itself to people it knows will die and allows them a way out of their end, linking all the way back to...
Okay. Why doesn't it give them a choice?
Yeah, no. Absolutely. It just, as if you touch it, it's a done deal. Why doesn't it give it a choice? No, because fate is absolute. Yeah. Unless it isn't, which means the subverted it, and thus new fate.
No,
because
that was always fate.
So...
But here's what...
And that's the problem with fate.
Here's the thing I'm saying with the stones. Why doesn't it show somebody the way they're going to die, and then just go, okay,
do you wish to go down this fated path?
Or do you wish to die now? And you could just go, I'll die now, and then you just fall out flat.
But no, somebody is about to die in some arbitrary amount of time.
And some arbitrary way.
And now the stone is just going to touch them, and they just decide to die peacefully.
What I spoke about at the very beginning. Although much darker and a far more grim way out than those granted to the Passione members, Rolling Stones is simply another manifestation of this, a reward for accepting fate's embrace. Rolling Stones shows us...
You're not accepting it. It's chasing after you, and if it touches you, you just go, we don't see somebody rejecting that fate. We see one person accepting it. And that's it. So it's not any of that.
As much like Diavolo being punished for defying fate, those who attempt to defy the stone by destroying it only serve to make their own death or the deaths of others worse.
Based on what? Yeah, that it happened?
We don't know what Bruno's original death was. So we can't say that it was made worse.
And we only know that it happens in the stone now because Bruno survived this encounter. So now other people are going to die because Bruno survived. Whereas before, only Bruno would have died. We don't know how horrific it would have been. We don't know nothing about this because fate does not show us because it don't matter.
So you're just supplanting this for some reason, even though it's unprovable. You're just saying this.
The stand's user, Scolopy, gives a critical speech to Mister on the theme of fate too. He makes reference to a famous quote from Michelangelo about the idea that his sculptures all had a fated form from the beginning and that he was simply uncovering this form. For me, here, I see many parallels between Michelangelo and Giorno. Giorno was not aware of...
So, we've gotten Giorno is Jesus, and now Giorno is Michelangelo, the artist.
Giorno was not aware of God Experience Requiem's actions. It simply acted on the will of fate, uncovering the absolute truth. I also see clear contrast between...
That's the statue in the beginning of Fighting Gold. So somebody else had that same thought that Giorno is...
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Oh, dear.
It simply acted on the will of fate, uncovering the absolute...
No, Stan just acted. Yeah, it had nothing to do with him.
And who isn't just acting on the will of fate?
Even Diavolo is. Even though he thinks he's subverting it, no, he's just acting within its confines.
You said people accepted their fate being in prison, Mista and Narancia, and
Words.
Watch words.
Simply acted on the will of fate, uncovering the absolute truth. I also see clear contrast between Michelangelo and Diavolo, as Diavolo did not believe he was uncovering fate, but instead that he was controlling it, sculpting his life to his desire.
Did Giorno believe he was uncovering fate?
No.
If he had taken the attitude of Michelangelo, he wouldn't have met the end.
And again, that has nothing to do with Giorno, because it was just his stand doing all that crap. He doesn't know what the happened.
No.
It wasn't like he instructed his stand, hey, we need to stop Diavolo, and then his stand went off and did it. His stand just activated his powers as it was meant to in the realm of when it was supposed to. Like, oh, you hit me? Well, now I'm activated.
Yep. And activation complete.
So... Giorno did none of that. So it wasn't like... what you're saying basically is Michelangelo put the scalpel on the brick, on the marble, and then the image just appeared. He didn't do anything. That's what it would be like for Giorno. But no, he sculpted it. Giorno did nothing with that.
Or lack thereof that he did. After this speech, Mister uses the fate in Rolling Stones to his own advantage. He knows his death is not fated to be here, so he throws himself out the window.
No, see, Rolling Stone only shows the person that's fated to die the earliest. So,
you know what? I don't care. Yeah. I was about to say, because it could have easily just switched to Mista's face. And then Mista would just be...
Yeah.
But I don't know why it didn't do that. Because he was supposed to, he was fated to... This is why fate is so stupid. You have something literally here that says... The earliest person that's going to die, I'm just going to give them a peaceful death. So so Mista jumps out the window.
Head first.
Head first and goes, oh.
I'm not fated to die soon.
So I'm not going to die.
I literally can't die.
He gets no brain damage or anything. And it's just like he died a week later in a coma. Nothing like that. He walks away unscathed. And you can't say that, you know... The stone isn't able to add people or change what it shows because it literally adds people after the fact. But you know what? Mista was always fated to do this. That's all fate is. He was always supposed to do this. He was not supposed to die there. He was those three people were always supposed to die. He was always supposed to break the stone.
It's the biggest problem with fate.
It matters not. It's
zero.
This is yet another example of the members in the gang not manipulating fate, but cleverly utilizing what was given to them in order to progress. However, we are shown that despite this being the intention, Mister's ignorance actually acted as a defiance of fate, setting the story in motion to begin and giving closure as to why Abaccio, Narancia, and Bruno had to die, despite their apparent acceptances of fate. One thing
despite,
I couldn't fix...
Despite it, they still died because somebody chose to subvert fate.
In that moment.
Why? Doesn't make any sense. He is unpunished, but others are. Just like Abaccio. Why?
One thing I couldn't figure out for certain is why Rolling Stones appears once more at the end. We are told it follows someone who's going to die soon, but none of the characters present die. My interpretation is that it is an indication of fate being on their side. Possibly that the stone is there as a protection, since it...
Is that even it? Because there was no face in it, nor the markings that it originally had. Was that even was it, that or even was it just stone?
That's a very good question. Also, to the fact that nobody else has brought this up, I can't imagine that that's Rolling Stone. I think that's just Mista's bad memory of it. He's just going, oh crap, it's Rolling Stones, and then it's just literally not.
Take on any of their images. However, the most important aspect is this. The stone has no form, no shape here, as if to imply that they will be the ones to mold it. Like,
oh my. So now they can mold fate to whatever they want it to be. They're not on a set path. They can do it whatever they want. Why? And fate. Whatever they choose to do, isn't that just what they were fated to do?
Mm-hmm.
Whatever if the you believe end in... outcome is, that is fate no matter what.
If you believe in fate, there is no choice.
None.
You didn't choose to do such and such and such. You were always fated to do that.
You were just on that path.
So they're not molding fate to anything. They're just doing what fate always intended them to do. Literally what fate is.
No shape here, as if to imply that they will be the ones to mold it. Like they have truly conquered fate. And finally, the epilogue closes with Polnareff proclaiming that their duty as the ones left standing will be done once Giorno puts the arrow in the turtle. The idea of duty is one related to obliged actions, perhaps ones a person must undergo due to them being fated. And really, this is the perfect closing for the part. All anyone ever does is their duty, the fated actions laid before them that they have to perform. It's how this part...
Yeah,
and all parts
like Dia. But he's punished.
Forever.
Yeah, like Mista, but other people are punished.
Jojo are carried out. It's how a story is told, and, if you believe it, it's how real life itself could be occurring right now, because, at the end of the day, we're all slaves. Sleeping slaves of fate.
Because nobody knows what fate is, or their fate is, so they can't mold it or struggle against it or anything. They're just going in the way that they are. Yes. So what's the story about?
Yep. We're all sleeping. What was good about it?
What was good about it?
How does Araki present the theme of fate? He doesn't. The fate just happens. As all series do.
So what's left? The story, the characters, the plot, the actions, the fight. Terrible. Now. Oh, is that actually it?
No, there's still 3 minutes
left. Hey guys, Rainbow Nebula here. Thanks for watching the video. I just wanted to do another little after video non-scripted bit like last time because I've got a couple of things to say. So first of all, thanks for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it.
You're welcome.
Please leave your opinions in the comments.
Please comment on my video.
Whatever. I want to know what people think about my interpretation of certain aspects of this part.
It's poop.
If you'd like to see more, because I would consider making this a mini series, or indeed looking at
four videos
other
by
parts
the way.
Or themes within part five, because there's loads to talk about in loads of different parts. If you'd like to see, you know, more similar analyses like this, then please let me know. Subscribe, share it, and yeah, just get it out there if you want more of it. And if you want other people to see it, I'd like other people to see it because I want to know other people's takes on my opinions. Second thing I should mention is that I was on a live stream with a couple of quite big names in the JoJo community. Well, a few, actually. So we have X-Force, Meti Not the Bad Guy, and NZ Anime Manga. Of course, it was a live stream hosted by NZ Anime Manga on his channel on Sunday, and
X-Force
it was great fun. It did get a bit hectic
boring.
Because we
are you
got
serious?
Seven people present. But we got to talk for about three to four hours about JoJo's, and it was, yeah, it was fantastic. So if you'd like to hear some really in-depth, interesting discussion on part seven and six, and we did get sidetracked with some other parts as well at different points, then you can go to NZ Anime Manga's channel. There'll be a link in the description to the live stream itself. It's still up as
there
a recording on his channel. So I definitely recommend, maybe if you don't watch the whole thing, just skip through it and see the main discussion points because it was really, really interesting. But if you liked my last video about Steel Ball, or indeed this video, you know, if you like deep discussion,
people hate part six,
I definitely suggest you go and check that out. Thirdly, I'd like to thank everyone again. Anyone that watched my last video, because the response to that amazed me. I really didn't expect to get more than 100 views maximum, and it's now.
Yeah, I don't care anymore. Now this is really hard to rate because I really do want to give it a negative 10, but I don't feel the negative 10.
I really do want to give it a negative 10, and I will. That Abakio part pushed it over the edge.
And that was like 3 minutes in.
Yeah, sure was. And he didn't recover.
He didn't recover a single half point.
Nope. Nanachi was like two sentences.
And he did just throw faded us over
and
over.
It's a negative 10. It was a really bad video.
It was a really bad video.
I am not coming out of that. Even if I was just like, oh, let's learn about this. I'm not coming out of this with anything more than what was presented with the word fate thrown at me every 5 seconds.
I feel like if it was actually an edited video, I could give it a 10. But I just can't.
I'm feeling it. It's the feeling. And
yeah,
I got the
you
feeling.
Can't. You can't help the you feeling. I'm going to go 9.5. I'm not going to go a 10.
Because my...
It was horrendous. And it's just something not pushing me over the edge. I'm hanging on with one finger to
it. I dig it. I dig it.
But I'm not over the edge.
This was a very bad video.
Yeah, this was bummer.
That was just nonsensical.
And that's the worst part. Like, the whole Abakio spiel? Like, what? Fugo is supposed to be neutral in fate? That's why...
Just because you have this outside dude. So no, I can't.
I understand.
It is what it is.
It is what it is. Well, we already know what we're doing next, so I don't know if we're doing it tonight anymore because this is tiring. Let's knock out that first part at least.
Yeah.
I'll get it and then we'll knock that out next time, which is just this time again.